This presentation is very new for me because it's actually the first time I'm talking about that. And I hope it's been, as you, everybody knows, 2 years, not totally 2 years, but that we are in a pandemic, and we had a lot of time to think. So that's my opinion. So with one of my great friend and colleague, Nicolas Moes, we thought to do something else that we were doing up to now. And so we brainstormed for let's say 2 or 3 months to find an idea of something. And the idea came out of this brainstorming is called, we call it XMesh. And that's the acronym is for extreme mesh deformation. And so this idea is meant to provide a solution to at least a very simple and reliable solution to the problem of front tracking or interface tracking in computational physics. So, and today I'm going to give you an example of that approach that applies to the classical Stefan phase change model. I will try to do some live demonstration of that method applied to Stefan problem. I mean, running the code and see the solution. This is very tricky, so it may fail. There is always what I call the demo effect. Anytime you want to do a demonstration live, it always fails normally, but maybe it's going to work. So let's hope for the best. So next slide. So as I said, the extreme mesh deformation approach is new, something completely new. It's meant to follow sharply interfaces without remeshing. I mean, we are going to do some front tracking on a mesh that has always the same topology, same number of nodes, same connectivity. We allow ourselves to move the nodes, okay, in a very strange fashion. And we are going to be able to follow, to track interfaces that may change of topology, may nucleate, coalesce, or split. And if you want to do that, our thing, we thought that the only way, at least we found a way to do that, is to allow fine elements, triangles, tetrahedra, to reach a zero measure. So if you think about that, if you're a finite element specialist, this is a kind of a forbidden room where nobody should enter. It's like in Parbleu, it's the forbidden room. It seems in every finite element book that if you do that, you are going to have something which is inaccurate, ill-conditioned, and not convergent. But if you allow that, I'm going to show you that you could do the thing I'm promising to do. I mean, follow interfaces in a sharp manner and always have the same mesh topology without changing, I mean, just changing the position of the nodes. Okay, so why am I doing that? All right. So just a small recall for the ones who don't know about Stefan model. It's a classical phase change model where you assume that the liquid is not in motion, it's at rest, okay? And you assume also that expansion due to freezing is neglected, which means that the density is constant, okay? And the phase change takes place at a certain temperature. Here we assume 0 degrees Celsius, okay? The free energy is continuous across the form, but the internal energy, the temperature, CPT, excuse me, is discontinuous across the front. And so in general, fronts appear in physics where you have physical property that depends in a discontinuous fashion with respect to the variables. Here, heat conductivity, thermal capacity, latent heat is discontinuous with respect to the fact that you're either in the liquid or in the solid. If you have that, then you have fronts that may be moving, coalesce, have a very large change of topologies. And so what is interesting to see is if you want to have an accurate representation of such a phenomenon, you should be able to take into account the things that are discontinuous across the front. But most people think that what is discontinuous across the front is spatially, of course, spatially, the heat flux is discontinuous across the front, but it's also discontinuous temporally, as you see. So the temperature is continuous in space and time. It's a function of two variables, x and t, which is continuous in space and time, but the derivatives may be discontinuous in space and in time across the front. If you want to have a convergent method, you should be able to at least mimic those discontinuities in your numerical scheme. So the best thing to do would be, if you use Fine-Clements, to always have, let's say, a sharp representation of the front. I mean, what I mean, it should have nodes, edges, and faces on the front. Oh, so a quick review of literature. Usually, the people use what I call a hunting metaphor. So the front is the prey, okay? And you may want to track the prey or capture the prey. Tracking the front, you follow the prey, okay? You follow the front in at all times, for example, using another grid like James Glynn was doing very long ago in the 1980s to track shocks. But the best option in today's modern method is to use an arbitrary Lagrange Eulerian method where interfaces are tracking inside the Fine-Clement mesh by simply moving the nodes. Of course, there are pros and cons to this method. The pros is it has excellent properties, mass conservation, accuracy, but it has cons. It's very difficult with ALE method to have very large deformations, very large changes of fronts or changes of topology. Of course, you can do ALE plus mesh adaptation, but there is a big drawback to that. There is a vicious drawback. It's this time continuity. When you add and remove, even if you don't change the solution, but if you change the mesh, you create a discontinuity in time that most of people don't see, but it's very obvious. If you double the number of nodes, if your solution is, let's say, in equilibrium with n nodes, if you just double the number of nodes, even though you have exactly the same solution, it's not the solution of your discrete problem anymore. And so you create some kind of discontinuity in time. So let's put it that way, these are tracking methods. So for the Stefan model, there are some people that have worked on tracking method for the Stefan problem. There are very new papers, like in 2019 with my good friend Marc Shepard, that has used discontinuous Galerkin method for doing such model. You have, on the other side, front capturing methods. Front capturing, you usually use a fixed mesh, and the interface is captured inside elements through different sorts of indicator functions. And the most well-known indicator function is, let's say, a level set, which would be a distance function to the front. And then you could use some tricks to represent sharply your fronts inside your element. For example, using extended finite element methods, but there are other ways to do that, GFEM, SDAs. So the pros of those methods is that topological changes are quite easy to deal with, not extremely easy with XFEM, because you have to add degrees of freedom, remove them. It's not that easy to have, let's say, complex topological changes with XFEM, but it's possible. Yet, there are a lot of issues like integration. Linear and bilinear form need to be integrated precisely on each side of the interface. We've got conditioning problems when elements are cut into small pieces, for example. You need to have space stabilization for stiff interfaces. Choose the proper space of Lagrange multiplier is difficult. You also have problems of time stabilization. There's a lot of problems, but for my opinion, the main problem of method like XFEM is that they don't fit into the standard finite element context. You have to touch it. It has lots of deep consequences in a given code. If you want to do XFEM on your given code, you have to change practically everything, and this is a very, very big con of those methods, because people that are, let's say, using industrial code, they don't want to change everything. They would like to change slightly thing, and working on the mesh is one of the things people like to do, because mesh are usually considered by practitioners as like an orthogonal component of the whole engineering analysis process. Yet using XFEM requires to do a lot of things. And that's, for my opinion, why it has not percolated completely into the industrial codes. So there are pros and cons of capturing method. And you have capturing method that capture interface in a diffuse manner. And so the interface is not sharply compute it, but it's like a diffuse interface. It's diffuse on a certain number of elements. Okay, the diffuse method may be physically based or numerically based. Of course, with diffuse method, topological changes are very easy to deal with. I know those methods it's using essentially anisotropic mesh adaptation, things like that, but the cons is actually not to over-diffuse. Of course, if you have a diffuse interface, you move it, and you move it into a region where, let's say, you have way less elements, it will diffuse on always the same number of elements, like 4 or 5. And so if you have a coarse mesh, your interface may diffuse or even disappear. So in order to maintain sharp variation, you have to do mesh adaptation. And mesh adaptation, as I said, may have difficulties to deal with continuous thinking time. So capturing methods have also the pros and cons. So you have also diffuse methods that have been and sharp front capturing method that have been devised for Stefan problem. So I know that the people that are looking at this slide could read it again. So I have put some of the good reference of that. Some of them are with XFAM, some other were like the one with Osher, use let's say simple level sets and diffuse methods. So what is our objective? Our objective is to find the good method to track interfaces. We want to have a time continuous deforming mesh with fixed topology that we want to have a mesh that deforms but keeps all adjacencies constant. We want to conform to sharp physical interface, which means we want to have a sharp representation of the fronts at all times. We want to be able to do very complex topological changes, arbitrarily complex, nucleation, collapse, coalescence, or splitting. And we don't want to enrich the finite element approximation. We want to keep the standard finite element code. So P1, P2, P4 ensures that the solution at the nodes evolves smoothly over time, which provide the benefits for good accuracy. Matching property 4, if you want to do P3 with the other 4, it's very complicated. Okay, and so that was our, let's say, goal when we started with Nicolas Moes to brainstorm. We want to have those 4 properties. And we thought about many things. After lots of, let's say, vain efforts and bad idea, we thought we could add a good idea. So that's our key idea. It may look surprising. So the first drawing that I show you here is essentially a 1D image of what is an arbitrary Lagrangian Eulerian method for front tracking. You have a front. The front is just like you have the liquid, which is in blue, and the solid, which is in black. And you've got the front, which is the bicolor node. And the bicolor node wants to move right. And so if you do ALE, you may want to move it from here to here. And of course, you're going to stretch the elements on the left side. You're going to compress the element on the right side. And if you want to be able to have something which is still accurate, and let's say keep the same number of nodes, you want to remesh the left part and to coarsen the right part. And this is the thing we don't want to do. We want to keep a mesh with fixed topology. Here, we've changed the mesh. We've changed the topology. It looks the same as that, but it's not the same mesh anymore because this node here has a lot of nodes on its left, and it had only 2 here. So here, we propose that thing, which may look a little bit surprising. We propose a thing like interface relaying. The word relaying is like in a relay race. You get the front is like a runner, and the guy runs to his right up to the point he meets. It meets the next node, and it gives the relay. The front gives the relay to that node, so that this node can go back to its original position, and the new guy that runs can run to the right, etc., etc. With that, you may be able to have let's say in 1D it looks simple, and I'll show in 2D it's still very simple. So when you do that, you may only have node motions, okay? And when the two nodes collide, they're gonna have exactly the same temperature, of course, because they are at the same position, and so you have continuity in time. That's looks, of course, very, very nice, and you can extend that ID to many other things. For example, you can imagine some kind of annihilation process. You've got two nodes, okay, two blue nodes, a blue region here, let's say, which is liquid, and two solid nodes that come to each other. And when they collide, you get annihilation of the liquid phase, and the nodes can go to their own original place. You remove the fraud. You could also do the other way around, which is called seeding. Seeding, you get two nodes which are solid, they collide, and then they get colder. And when they get colder, they can create, they can nucleate a new phase in the in the mesh. And then you get something, and I'm not going to talk about, but this is really related to crack propagation. You could have twinning. And twinning, which means actually you add a model which depends essentially on the size of the elements. You could move from, let's say, a model which is with damage to crack with that. Here you get a damage model that could essentially nucleate a crack inside a damage zone. So that's what we try to do now. Of course, I'm not going to present that today. Okay, zero measure elements. So this is quite surprising because, as I said, usually people would consider that as kind of forbidden. And I'm a mesh generation guy, as probably some of you know. So I've been working on mesh generation for years, and mesh algorithms are supposed to try their best not to do things like that. We have lots of paper, for example, in 3D to remove slivers in 3D meshes, because slivers are they are difficult to remove and they have a zero volume. And it's considered as a bad idea to do a simulation with elements of zero volume. But we are going to say that it's just not true. It's not true at all. So we know, and everybody that has had a, let's say, a good finite element course has heard about the famous Babushka and Aziz paper of 1976. That says, and what there's nothing wrong in this paper, of course, they say that it's the paper is well written, but it's usually not really good. It's sometimes misinterpreted. Is a sufficient condition for having convergent finite solution with mesh refinement is that angles should be bounded from above. So you should never have obtuse angles when you refine a mesh that becomes more and more and more obtuse. What is clear reading that paper is that it's a sufficient condition. It's a sufficient condition. If you do that, you are sure that you converge. But it's not necessary a necessary condition. And we looked at the literature and we didn't find, we are sure, in fact, that there is no, that today there exists nowhere in the literature somewhere that says a necessary condition for having finite element, convergent finite element solution with mesh refinement is. So now we have, with all our brainstorming, we have a conjecture on that. But there is no, today, there is no necessary condition. There is a sufficient condition, but there's a lot of necessary condition possible, sufficient condition, there's no necessary condition. So we found some papers, very interesting paper, not very cited, but very precise. And it's been shown that there exist meshes that do not respect the angle condition and that converge anyway, both in L2 and H1 norm. So don't, in also for derivatives. So if you look at the right mesh, this is a perfectly valid mesh. It's perfectly correct, and it will not, if you take those needles, the needles are the triangles which have one very small edge, okay, and a very small volume. A cap is a triangle which has a very small volume, but no very small edge, a very obtuse angle. If you have those caps and needle and put their measured zero, the only issue you will have here is condition. In terms of accuracy and convergence, it doesn't harm it at all. So in reality, some people have proven that you can have optimally convergent finite element solution, but with meshes that are visually unpleasant. Of course, if you look at that, it's visually unpleasant. I know that, why I say that, because it's been years that I work on mesh generation and people like to have beautiful meshes with equilateral triangles, beautiful tets and hexes, etc. Here it's not beautiful, but it's really a valid mesh, finite element mesh. What we just found out is that the family of computational acceptable mesh can include patterns, bands, okay, of needles. But what is really important, if you cannot have bands of caps, okay? The caps, so the tooth angle, can be isolated, there's no problem, but they cannot form bands, okay? And in a very good paper from Professor Kuchera from Prague, wrote something which is really quite interesting. It says one can fabricate very strange triangulation, satisfying the assumption of its theory about, you know, those good meshes that are visually unpleasant. It also talks about damaged meshes, but such meshes are perhaps not, have no value from a practical point of view. In fact, they have, at least with our point of view of front tracking, they have a great value. And so are there meshes that are really unacceptable, not computerly acceptable? Yes. And these are the ones that are described in the original paper of Babushka. It's meshes that contains bands of caps like the ones you see on the image. If you have a band of cap like that, and you make those meshes, those bands go to a zero measure, you have a very well-known locking phenomenon. In fact, along the band, the solution must be linear. It's easy to see. It must be linear. And so it's a locking problem. And we found a way to avoid, to deal with those meshes. But this implies something which is not continuous in time anymore. Okay. And so our conjecture that we may want to prove is that the pattern of that figure, this is not figure five, is the only possible non-compliant pattern, not LBB compliant pattern in 2D. That's our conjecture. We are not sure, but at least we conjecture that. So what happens at the zero measurement? So in absence, when you don't have that forbidden pattern, the only issue is conditioning. So we have a methodology to avoid conditioning, is to dualize. It's very classical if you do, for example, contact, et cetera, you dualize. You dualize the relation that makes the problem ill-conditioned, okay? For example, if you have a stiffness matrix of elasticity and a pair of triangles with a very small edge, you do dualize the displacement across this edge with the force. And if you do that, the condition number of the matrix is independent of the fact that the element goes to zero. And adding degrees of freedom in this context doesn't create discontinuity in time, because you have exactly the same solution as you would have if you were able to use exact arithmetics and solve very ill-conditioned problems. So we want to deal, we want to deal with the forbidden pattern as well. I'm not going to talk about that. It's possible, but choosing a right space for Lagrange multiplier. You don't put all the Lagrange multiplier, but a certain subset. So an example, very, very stupid. We've got here a mesh, and we are going to reduce the size of some of the elements. You see here, we are going, this band here, like here, this band is going to be reduced to zero. So one of the elements, if we zoom here, is going to have a zero size with all the edges zero. We get needles and one isolated cap here. Okay, so it's, we are in the right position in terms of the theorem you just saw before, or in terms of the conjecture, we don't have a bands of caps. If we dualize, of course, it's a very simple problem. If we dualize, we don't get more error, neither in H2 or L2 norm, okay, in H1 or L2 norm, and we keep the condition number at the same level, even when we reduce the an aspect ratio of the mesh to the 10 to the power 13, so we have got really zero measure. So we come from here to here, excuse me. We start from this one and then we reduce, I think it's, which band? It's that band. That band is reduced. That band is reduced, and here we go there. Of course, we have larger elements here, so the error grows a little bit, okay, because we have got larger elements, but it's normal, H grows a little bit, so we get an error which is a little bit bigger. Okay, we dare to use zero measure elements. So it's a long slide, but I'm going to show you a live example of that, which is when in dimension two, we can do also front relay. And this consists of 30 lines of Python. So what I'm going to show you is 30 lines of code. Of course, we use Gmesh's API. So we read the mesh, we get the connectivity. We, of course, the 30 line doesn't include IOs, But this is the whole process for doing the mesh deformation. And so the algorithm explained here, it's quite simple. It's as usually when you do mesh adaptation, it's in heuristics. But this heuristic, we tried many things. It's this one seems to be the one which is essentially the most robust. It's absolutely robust. So we start from a front, okay? We compute a new temperature field and we want to move the nodes in order to adapt to the new temperature field. So we do these target nodes and et cetera. We find paths which are the shortest paths using the normals. So the whole thing you may want to look here is that we only move the node across along the edges of the existing mesh. That's the first thing. And when the mesh has moved, if a node now is far away from the front, it goes back to its initial position, gently. So let's try a live thing on that. I hope it's going to work. Tell me if you see something. So this is it. So, okay. So this is, let's say, so of course here it's just a level set. You make it move, of course, and we here get annihilation, nucleation, merging of the fronts, okay? Then we get separation, annihilation, and again, okay? 30 lines of code. The mesh doesn't change of topology, but if you see, we have elements that go, that passes through a zero measure. If you see here, bang, bang, etc. I know it's nice, I've been hypnotized by that thing for days. It's quite cool. And it's 30 lines of code, it's absolutely unbreakable. And the code will be available in 1 or 2 weeks when we've submitted the paper. So it's very, very simple, extremely, ridiculously simple. Okay, so you see that's just a level set that follows the front. Okay. So that's my live demonstration. Okay, so you could see that. I think we have a film on that for days. So here, now let's try to apply that to a true physical problem, not just moving a level set. So the Stefan model is just solving equation of diffusion on both solid and liquid phase. Okay, and then you've got an interface that actually moves. And the motion of the interface essentially depends on the jump of the heat flux across the interface, multiplied, and also it depends on the latent heat that exists. And so if you solve this equation, what you must know is that the liquid and solid phase are depends on the temperature, and so the coefficients of the equation here actually are discontinuous with respect to the discontinuity with respect to the temperature. Okay, so that's our model. Another thing which is important is that you've got normally a Dirichlet boundary condition, and you've got a Dirichlet boundary condition on the front, which is gamma. Okay, but we are not going to apply this boundary condition as the other boundary condition. This is going to be the convergence criterion for our Newton algorithm. So the temperature will not be fixed at the front at the high temperature. It will be it will be zero, thanks to a convergent Newton scheme. So when you write a reformulation of that, you say that the difference of the thermal energy depends on the fact that you are diffusing some stuff, and here W is the motion of the mesh, okay? It's the motion of the front, but also to all the nodes that are moving due to the fact that the nodes that are away from the front goes back to their original position to keep a good mesh on both sides of the front. And so this is our weak formulation. This is a weak formulation which is not that classic, okay? So Nicolas Moes has worked a lot on that to give us something which is pretty nice. And at the end of the day, we want to solve this Stefan problem on a mesh that has a fixed topology, node position are changing, the configuration change an element during time can become, can liquefy or solidify. Okay, so between one set. So in ALE approach, elements are always on the same side of the front. Here, an element can go from one side of the front to the other side in one given iteration. Okay, the problem is nonlinear, and we use what I call a quasi-Newton scheme. I'm not going to explain, I don't have time, because this we have many ways to linearize this problem. So we found two ways, and the funny thing that works the best, we call the term the train term, because we found the right formulation in the train going back to Nantes 1 month ago. So we will call it the train term. And I don't know why it works, but it's intuitively it should work, but I've never been able to understand exactly why it works. Okay, so let me show you that it works. So we can solve the Stefan problem analytically in 1D, either in, let's say, in 1D or in axisymmetric coordinates. So I give you here the speed of the front depends on the square root of time. It's very classical. Multiply by a coefficient phi, that is the solution of this nonlinear equation that depends on the variables of the problem. Okay, so this is an image, okay, of what it does, but it's not really interesting an image. I'm going to try again to show you how it works live. So I'm going to solve it live. Okay. Of course, it's 1D, but it's 2D. Huh? Okay, so here it is. So we don't start at the right because it's really discontinuous at t equals zero. We get an infinite speed. It's not really fun. So we put the initial solution, which is the analytical solution, with a front here. And so I've put very large time steps here. Let's go. So what you see here is essentially all the iteration, all the Newton iterations. So you see that the motion shows all the Newton iterations. So most of the iterations are, if you look here, I'm going to 10 to the minus 6 here. So here, it was quite well. The front is not completely straight. We know it could be better if we converge better. But at least if you look here, the analytical solution, I put the points, I think we're not that bad. Okay, so this is with the true parameters of ice and water with latent heat and everything. Okay, so this is with the true parameters. So it works quite well, we think. Okay, and of course we did some other things. We did the axisymmetric one, which is, I think, a little bit funnier to see. Okay, okay. So we start again with the analytical solution. We don't put a point in the middle because of course there is a singularity. So we start with the front, which is at that direction. And here I'm not going to show you the intermediate Newton positions of the front, only the position of the front at the end. So. So it's kind of advanced. And if you see the analytical solution, the comparison with analytical solution is on the slide here. I didn't put by plot to draw it, etc. So it's strange. So if you see here, there is a relaxation where elements slowly come back to their initial position. And of course, because the front is normal, you start to generate kind of a structure mesh behind the front coming from a let's say a triangular equilateral mesh. Anyway, it works quite well and it's very stable. It doesn't require, you see here, the number of iteration is like 14 iteration. And we jump, I think, of at least two elements per time step. Okay, here I should do that. Okay. So you see here the front is going to go away. Oh, let's go. And then when it goes away, of course, you only have diffusion anymore, and then points go back to their initial position, which is nice, exactly what we expect. Okay, so the last results that I show you are from yesterday. So you see, it's very, I'm very happy to be able to show that because we find finally a good linearization for them. So we did other, I did this morning other examples. I started with a very strange temperature field with many, many fronts, okay, like that. So it's, and then you let it evolve and you get annihilation, non-nucleation here, essentially annihilation here, and then everything goes dead. I've done, I think, other examples. That one, I move a heat source like that, like an infinite shape. And so it just cools down and then, it heats up and then cools down because the temperature outside is negative. And after a certain number of turns, you get that kind of funny shape. And so it's very fast, and it's only 165 time steps were to go there with the full model. Okay, conclusion. One key ID, just zero measure element. Consequence, we can do extreme mesh deformation, which is, in my opinion, pretty cool. Of course, there is issues. In 2D, the mesh deformation algorithm is trivial and robust. In 3D, it will be more complicated. I say way more complicated than my first. I started to work on that, and it's not that complicated. It's complicated. We still have to work on the semi-monolithic solver to accelerate the convergence. As I told you, it's only 2 days ago or yesterday, we get very good convergence. We are starting on that. In 3D, more issues are expected on the side of the zero size elements. For example, there is a zoo of tiny tetrahedra. There's a zoo. And so you have got skinny tetrahedra, like the ones here, and the flat tetrahedra, which are here, which are like the needles and the caps of in 2D. What we conjecture is that what it happens in 2D is in 3D. Some flat tetrahedra must remain isolated so that it cannot form bends in order to avoid the locking phenomenon. But the bends cannot be only slivers, they're going to be caps and slivers. Okay, we conjecture that allowing the emergence of slivers makes the extreme deformation possible for manifold closed surfaces. And that's what I show here. If you allow a sliver to be present, okay, you could, because here, imagine you want to have this surface, you want to have this mesh conforming to the surface. If the surface cuts three edges of a tetrahedron CZ, when it cuts four edges, an easy way to deal with that is to allow this tetrahedron to become a sliver. So if you can deal with isolated sliver in a mesh, then you could be able to do what I've done in 2D, in 3D. That's my conjecture. I just thought about that on paper. So I think I'm done. Thank you for your attention. And I'm open for questions. I think I still have time for questions, I think. Thank you.
Merci, Jean-François. Contrary to what I've said before, I think that my students will have to wait a bit before. It was very interesting.